हेलो फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज़ प्रोफेसर बंसोड़े। टुडे विल डिस्कस द कंसेप्ट ऑफ सेपरेशन ऑफ पावर। देर इज़ अ मैक्सिम, पावर करप्ट्स एंड एब्सोल्यूट पावर करप्ट्स एब्सोल्यूटली। नाउ सेपरेशन ऑफ पावर इज़ अ कंसेप्ट इन विच वी आर अंडरस्टैंडिंग दैट वेन एवर देर इज़ अ कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ऑफ पावर एट वन ऑर्गन और वन अथॉरिटी, that may lead to the arbitrariness in the system, a dictatorship in the system, and to avoid this particular bad element in the system, there is a need of a decentralization of powers or functions of various organs of the government. And so when we are looking at the very three organs of the government, that is legislature, executive and judiciary, the functions of all these three organs, they rightly demarcated. And so when we are saying a legislature is having a function of lawmaking, executive they are having a function of implementation or execution of law, and judiciary they are having the function of interpretation of law. So in the separation of power, it is expected that all these three organs, they should perform their very basic, inherent and essential functions, what recognized with them under the law. And so theory of a separation of power try to protect the system from converted into the very authoritative rule of one particular organ or authority. Because there is a maxim, power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And so if the concentration of all functions you could see in one organ or one authority, there is a danger that the whole system can collapse or can destroy. And so in the system there should be a balance. Montesquieu is the author of this particular theory, and we can understand that this theory is rooted in the US legal system, in which there is a written constitution, presidential form of government, and at the same time a very strong judicial review. You can understand in US legal system. So the concept of separation of power, basically they accepted it in the sense that there should be a watertight compartment in regards with the functions of a respective three organs of the government, and there should not be any overlapping. So it means that the legislature should not in any way interfere with the functions of a judiciary, or judiciary should not interfere with the functions of executive. So in that way they understood the concept of separation of power. But practically it is not possible that one organ will operate in its own demarcated field and there will not be any overlapping with the another organ. In the US legal system itself, if we could see that the constitution of US provides the authority of veto power to the president for passing of any particular bill, whatever which is with majority passed by the parliament or the Congress of US. And so to that extent president can be said to be exercising a legislative functions. In the appointment of high officials, there is a need of approval of a Senate. Whenever treaty is made by the president, until and unless Senate is not approving that treaty, the very enforcement of that treaties or the effect of that treaty is not possible. So these are the very transactions in which the executive, they are very authoritatively interfering in the functions of the legislature, or sometimes legislatures, they are interfering with the functions of executive. And so this interference of one organ with the another organ justified in the very theory of separation of power on the basis of the concept of checks and balances. That is, the functioning of one organ is to be checked or is to be measured by the another organ. And in that manner, it is very incidental, it is very natural that whenever one organ performs their respective function, the other organ can create a very checks and balances on the very performance of that organ's function. And so that the system can be balanced in that way. And so the doctrine of separation of power in US or in United States of America, we could understand, they consider as a very barrier or hurdle in the very development of administrative law also. Because in the concept of administrative law, when we are understanding that so many socio-economic problems in the modern age, they warranted for the establishment of new institutions with the new procedures. And because of this new institutions and new procedures what develop, there is a very threat apprehension arose for the doctrine of separation of power. And so administrative law consider as like an attack on the very notion, traditional notion of separation of power. But then gradually even the very system of Americans, they also consider that the development of administrative law along with the separation of power, that is a very necessity of today's era. And so the concept of delegated legislation in the USA introduced, and it was approved by the Court of United States. But at the same time, court imposed the reasonable restrictions on the part of Congress, that while delegating the power to the executive, that is a lawmaking power which delegated to the executive, the Congress must let down the very policies framework so that the executive should not in excessive manner use the very functions of the legislature or the Congress. But it is practically difficult to develop that particular control over delegated legislation in the system like United States, because there is a constitutional doctrine of a separation of power, which in the system of United States was deeply rooted. And so deviation from that separation of power was not accepted in initial phase in the United States of America. But later on, we understood that with the enactment of Independent Statutory Commission, which have the legislative power, administrative power, adjudicatory power, and so one particular commission is having the powers of all the organs. And even to this independent statutory commission, the Supreme Court of US rightly accepted, and Supreme Court of US didn't find any wrong in it. So the aim of doctrine of separation of power basically to guard the system against the arbitrary powers, tyrannical powers in the system, and it creates a checks and balances over the very functions of the government or the functions of various organs of the government. And so the rationale behind this doctrine is that if all powers is concentrated in one and the same organ or person, there would arise the danger that it may enact the arbitrary laws, tyrannical laws. They may execute them in a despotic manner and in the fashion without any control, without any restraint. And so, for the protection of liberty of individual, for the protection of freedom of individual, and for the maintenance of a fair system in the functioning of each and every organ of the government, the theory of separation of power is a very important concept. In the complex socio-economic problems, and when we are saying we are now in the modern welfare state, it is not possible that we should follow strictly the concept of separation of power in a traditional manner. There is a need of a recognition of separation of power along with the checks and balances. And so when administrative authority, they are having the function of legislature, they are having the function of their own execution, and they are having the function of adjudicatory natures. So it may lead to administrative arbitrariness. And to check that administrative arbitrariness in the modern welfare state era, along with the separation of power, there is a need to recognize the concept of checks and balances also. And so, the theory of separation of power basically safeguards a very arbitrary misuse of power, or safeguards against the arbitrary misuse or abuse of power, and it laid down the broad line of an efficient division of functions. In the same manner, in 1946, when in the US the Administrative Procedure Act enacted, that also was considered as a very important development in regards with the recognition of administrative law in the backdrop of theory of separation of power. And so slowly Americans or the US, they accepted the very system of administrative law in which the theory of separation of power along with the theory of or concept of checks and balances, we are recognizing the very fair government in it. In India, you can say we always maintain the very separation of power. Rather, in the Constitution of India, that is expressly provided. We being having a very parliamentary democracy, parliamentary form of government, the legislature, executive and judiciary, they are having their own functions to perform. The doctrine of fundamental right always helps to create a checks and balances over the very administrative agencies or authorities or executive organs itself. judicial review always help to control, to limit the excessive power, arbitrary power of the any organ of the government. When you are talking about the theory of separation of power along with the checks and balances, even in Indian legal system, we are following the same philosophy. Rather, when we are talking about the legislative power, so legislative power of lawmaking can be transferred or delegated to the executive, and as like US, even in India also, the executive organ, whenever exercising the lawmaking function, they should exercise that lawmaking function with the mandate of the parliament or with the very demarcated field, whatever recognized by the parliament. And so, in the development of this particular separation of power, we recognize that this theory of a separation of power basically provides the principle of decentralization, and for that reason the functions as expressly given in the constitution, that functions essentially needs to be recognized with the respective organs, and these organs, they should be known with these respective functions. When one organ is over excessively using that power, because today we are living in the administrative age, and so only administrative organ or executive organ is having the power of all the other organs, and so this organ should not be dominated in the system, and for that reason the separation of power we need to understand along with the very concept of checks and balances. And so the judiciary rightly, with the help of concept of judicial review, they are protecting this particular system with the very effect of administrative arbitrariness. And so in this manner the concept of separation of power can be understood in today's era. So I am here stopping with this particular note. This concept of separation of power will help you in your studies if you are a student of administrative law, constitutional law, or the student of political science. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.